crafts and industries. Indian crafts flourished during Mughal period. Cotton textiles were most important and 150 types of fabrics were produced. Emperor Akbar encouraged the production of silk and Bengal became a very important center for raw silk. The craftsman's home became the workshop. Many of them settled in large numbers in and around the centers of export along the coast, trade centers and in European factory towns. Craftsmanship achieved high level of efficiency. In the pre-British era, the artisans mainly catered to the needs of village community, while in big towns there were craftsmen who were patronized by local rulers and nobles. These craftsmen produced luxury goods for the traders who sold them to other countries. There was a great demand for items like woolen, silk and cotton textiles, jute, saltpeter, opium, spices, etc. in Europe. The fine cotton cloth, especially the darker muslin, were in great demand all over the world. The industries in town were well organized in guilds, which provided protection and also regulated prices and quality of goods. As the Mughal Empire became weak, urban skilled craftsmen flourished in regional centers like Banaras, Patna, Surat, Lucknow, Jhansi, Gwalior, etc. Each of these specialized in a particular craft. But things changed with the arrival of European trading company. The period of modern imperialist expansion was marked in India by an intensification of British exploitation and a corresponding change in its character, in which the capitalist exploitation of India came to dominate all other methods. Nevertheless, new methods of exploitation did not replace the already established forms of plunder, industrial and trading mistreatment, but was supplementary to these processes. Decline of handicrafts. The Indian handicrafts faced a sharp decline with the advent of British from the 19th century. East India Company began to monopolize the artisans and started dictating its own terms to the craftsmen. The commercial policies of British government were largely influenced by imperialistic regime in India. During the later half of 18th century and the first half of 19th century, Britain underwent profound socio-economic transformation due to industrial revolution, and the British industry developed and expanded rapidly on the basis of modern machines, factory system and capitalism. By means of imperialism, British also captured and monopolized markets in Asia and Africa. It now had a strong industrial class in whose interest manufactured goods were exported to vast markets provided in the form of colonies. Thus, the British government followed a policy of free trade or unrestricted entry of British goods in India in the 19th century. The Indian handicrafts were exposed to an unequal competition of machine-made goods from the British. The Indian handmade goods were unable to compete with the much cheaper machine-made foreign products. The Indian products which competed with British products were subjected to heavy duties when exported. The duties on some of these exports were as high as 400%. This led to the decline of Indian export market. The desire for raw materials to keep the British industrial revolution going led to these drastic measures. The British commercial policy was guided by the needs of the British industry, with the main aim of selling British goods and a regular supply of raw materials. Some of the factors that led to the downfall of Indian industries are as follows. Imposition of heavy duties on Indian imports. The British policy of free trade in India. Exporting raw materials from India in large quantities. Oppression of weavers, as they were paid less amount than the usual price. The unfair competition with British machine-made goods. Call-outs attitude of British administration towards Indian weavers. The Industrial Revolution. In early medieval period, non-agricultural goods were produced in rural households in England. Later, when towns grew, goods began to be made in crafts guilds. As this method did not satisfy the growing demand of goods, a new method called domestic system came up. The production units were still located in houses, but now merchants supplied raw materials to these units. The craftsmen used simple tools to produce finished goods, which were then collected by the same merchant who sold them in the market. Even this system was inadequate to keep up with the demand. Meanwhile, many new machines were invented, like the steam engine, the spinning jenny, cotton gin, and power loom. So, a new system of production called factory system arose. The workers went to work in a building called factory owned by a capitalist. They were paid wages by the capitalist. Production was carried on with the help of a large number of machines, mainly run by steam power. This shift of production by machines led to the advent of machine age. Production multiplied many times. The series of industrial and technological by changes that began in the late 18th century, resulting in cheap and efficient mass production of different types of goods, came to be known as Industrial Revolution. As a result of Industrial Revolution, rate of production went up. New goods were produced. More people were able to afford goods which were termed as luxury goods. There was large-scale migration of people from villages to towns as employment opportunities expanded, wages increased, and more leisure time was available. As people crowded in towns, their living conditions became deplorable with problems of housing and sanitation. Poor sewerage system led to epidemics. Women and children were employed in large numbers in factories with no safety standards. Men, women, and children worked long hours for poor wages. There was no security of jobs, and if the machines went out of order, the workers had to work even longer hours. The Industrial Revolution brought nations together through developments in the transport and communication. Before the revolution, India had supplied finished goods to England. But things changed with the Industrial Revolution. The search for raw materials, markets, and cheap labor began by the industrialized European countries. The machines worked faster and demanded more and more raw materials. They also produced products which needed to be sold in the world market. With this, the trading depots expanded into colonies. The European powers then took political control of these countries so that they could have monopoly over trade and commerce. They also wanted to control economic policies of these countries. This is why an era of imperialism began with the advent of the 19th century. The changes took place as a result of British conquest of India are, after 1757, more and more areas came under the direct control of the company. To help the British made goods reach the interiors of India and to procure raw materials, roads were improved and canals were made suitable for steamboats. But it was the railway network crisscrossing India that changed the face of India. It helped the movement of goods, troops and people. With the building of Suez Canal, India came closer to England and it became cheaper to bring British goods to India. Since these were machine-made goods, they were cheaper than the handmade products produced by our craftsmen. So, they drove our artisans out of business. What damaged most of our indigenous industries was free trade. It meant movement of goods between countries without payment of duties or customs. One-way free trade meant that British goods coming into India paid no duties, while Indian goods entering England were made to pay prohibitive duties. This was the demand of the rising manufacturing class of England, which put a lot of pressure on the British government to follow this policy. Thus, Indian import into England was discouraged and British goods into India were encouraged. In 1813, the British government abolished the monopoly of the company to trade in India and the East. It now opened its trade to all British subjects. The Indian handmade goods were unable to compete against the much cheaper products of British mills. The factories used better techniques and steam power. Soon, British goods started flooding Indian markets. At the same time, Indian goods sent to Britain faced heavy growth of modern industries. The British government gave priority to jute textiles, coal mining, and cotton textile industries. The first jute mill was set up with British capital in Bengal, which was followed by setting up of jute mills at other places. coal mining also flourished in India, as it was an attractive business for British investors. There was a great demand of coal in railways and factories. Coal and iron ores are essential for the establishment of iron and steel industry. But the same could not be done as British government placed several restrictions on it. It was only in 1907 that Jamshedji Tata set up Iron and Steel Company at Jamshedpur. Due to several restrictions imposed by the British, the heavy industries could not develop at the required pace in India. Cotton textile industry, however, grew rapidly in the second half of the 19th century. The first textile mill was set up at Bombay in 1853. Later, many textile mills were set up at various places like Ahmedabad, Madras, Bengal, Solapur, Nagpur, etc. By the turn of the century, India had more than 200 cotton textile mills. Just before the First World War, India ranked fourth among the textile producing countries in the world. Although there was an intense competition from Britain and Japan, the Indian industry developed at a fast pace. Modern industries led to unemployment of thousands of craftsmen and artisans of India. They had no other alternative but to become workers in big factories. Industrial development in India was lopsided as industries were localized in a few big cities while the rest of the part remained semi-developed and underdeveloped. Heavy industries were largely neglected. It created an impediment for the growth of other industries too. Machinery and technology was imported from outside. Plantation industry was wholly owned by the foreigners and Indians were mere workers in these plantations. The British gave a stepmotherly treatment to the indigenous industries. They did not give any encouragement or protection to Indian industries. For example, the traditional and flourishing handloom industry of India suffered a decline due to imported foreign textiles. In comparison to foreign goods, higher freights were charged on the Indian goods. The British did not provide the benefit of banking, insurance, loan, etc. to the Indian industries. As a result of industrialization, two new social classes emerged in India, the capitalists and workers. Since their interests clashed with each other, the gulf between the two classes widened. The slow pace of industrialization in India resulted in the backwardness of the economy of the country. Textiles, a case study. The discovery of several spindles and a piece of cotton stuck to a silver vase revealed that spinning and weaving of cotton was known to the Harappans. References to weaving are found in Vedic literature, including the methods of spinning. The foundations of the Indian textile trade with other countries began as early as 2nd century BCE. A hoard of block-printed fabrics found in the tombs of Fostat in Egypt are the proof of large-scale Indian export of cotton textiles to Egypt from early times. In India, the archaeological finds include several tools used in processing cotton into cloth, portion of woven madderite cotton cloth and needles. Surviving pieces of sculptures from these early sites show that garments were not stitched and their designs indicate use of either embroidery or block printing. Many Indian texts contain references to textile techniques and guilds of weavers, further documenting knowledge of textiles. The best early documentation of the sophistication and variety of textiles worn several hundred years ago comes from the paintings of Ajanta Caves. They verify that the weaving of fine muslins and decorative designs, embroidery, brocades and tie-dye already existed in Indian society. During the course of our history, notable migration of Islamic group affected the textile traditions of India. Many of these people came from Central Asia, which has a cold climatic condition. Their sewn garments required special lightweight fabrics during hot Indian summer. Jamdani, an extremely fine Bengal muslin, began to be used for upper garments. Many Persian craftsmen too entered India, who provided an infusion of new techniques. Aleppo cloth, known as mashru, was introduced. With the advent of Europeans, many Indian clothing and textile terms like calico, shins, khaki, muslin, pajama, shawls, etc. entered English and other European languages. India was a major player in the world export market for textiles in the early 18th century. But by the middle of 19th century, it had lost all its export market and much of its domestic trade. While India introduced about 25% of world industrial output in 1750, it had fallen to only 2% by 1900. The exploitative British policies were accountable for this sharp decline. Cloth played a noteworthy role in our independence movement. Mill owners in Ahmedabad and Bombay financially supported Mahatma Gandhi, even though he advocated hand spinning of cotton yarn as a way for villagers to earn extra income and for the urban middle classes to identify with rural groups and artisans. Cotton textiles in India have now become a well-established manufacturing industry and employ more workers than any other sector. The textile industry of India is undergoing a major reorientation towards non-clothing application of textiles known as technical textiles. The variety and abundance of handcrafted textiles in India is unmatched anywhere in the world. Our main export market is Russia and other former Soviet republics. The power loom sector forms the largest portion of the decentralized part of the textile industry and dominates India's garment export industry.